The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. Welcome to Divine Service today. It's the 11th Sunday after Pentecost in the church year. This morning we'll use Divine Service 3. Starts on page 184. Please note, when we get to the Lord's Prayer, we'll speak it all the way up to where you got the music for Thine is the Kingdom and the Power and the Glory. So we'll sing that part. Helps us remember, if you look in the Bible, that part actually was added by the church later as a burst of praise at the end of the Lord's Prayer. So remember that little distinction. Couple of reminders for this week. Of course, after service today, we'll continue with our Bible study on outreach. And Tuesday, as you can see with some of the posters around the building and the banners outside, we'll have the National Night Out, which has become a regular thing for us, which is, as I've learned, is part of the Neighborhood Watch. And, you know, trying to invite people from your neighborhood to stop by. There is a sign-up on the door by the copier room, if you can bring anything for that. But more importantly, we hope you'll come. It's just for a couple of hours, 5 to 7 on Tuesday. Bring a lawn chair, and it's just an opportunity for us, if we get some people from the neighborhood to stop by to interact and visit with them, learn about what they hear going on in the neighborhood, tell them about our church. So it's just an opportunity to interact, but we need all of us to think about coming to that, because it's important for us to be there for that. And then we'll be continuing with class on Wednesday, and other things coming up down the road a little bit, so do take note of that. Want to mention also Judy Bremmel had heart surgery last week. I didn't get a chance to talk to Diane again to get another update. She's doing well? Good, yeah. Saw her the day after the surgery. She was doing really well. I think I saw last night she was on Facebook. So, so she must be doing pretty good if she's on Facebook, because that can be stressful. You know, Facebook can be stressful. So there's a lot of bad news on there. So keep her in your prayers, as well as a number of others. We have her listed in the news and notes. We had the service part of the bulletin printed up already before we knew about that, so she'll be in that part next time round. So I think that's about it as far as reminders, and I always want to tell people too, don't forget to check out the church library if you need something good to read in the summer. There's a lot of variety of books in there, and there's been a few new ones in there on one of the shelves in there too if you're looking for something recent. All right, let's begin today. The first hymn is 621. 621. Thank you. Please stand. We follow Divine Service 3, page 184. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. We pause to examine our thoughts, words, and deeds in light of God's Ten Commandments. Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now we turn to the bulletin insert, to the intro it, and Pastor sings the first and last verse.
With upright heart he shepherded them and guided them with his skillful hand. He commanded the skies above and opened the doors of heaven. And he rained down on them manna to eat and gave them the grain of heaven. Man ate of the bread of the angels. He sent them food in abundance. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now and will be forever. Amen. With upright heart he shepherded them and guided them with his skillful hand. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, God the Father Almighty, begotten Son, Jesus Christ, Lord God. That takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takest away the sin of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy, thou only art the Lord, thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high in the glory of God the Father.
Let us pray. Merciful Father, you gave your Son Jesus as the heavenly bread of life. Grant us faith to feast on him in your word and sacraments, that we may be nourished unto life everlasting through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated. The Old Testament reading is from Exodus chapter 16. The whole congregation of the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the people of Israel said to them, "Would that we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the meat pots and ate bread to the full. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Behold, I am about to rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a day's portion every day, that I may test them whether they will walk in my law or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather daily." So Moses and Aaron said to all the people of Israel, "At evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, for he has heard your grumbling against, because he has heard your grumbling against the Lord. For what are we that you grumble against us?" And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you in the evening meat to eat, and in the morning bread to the full, because the Lord has heard your grumbling, that you grumble against him, what are we? Your grumbling is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the people of Israel, come near before the Lord, for he has heard your grumbling." And as soon as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the people of Israel, they looked toward the wilderness, and behold, the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. And the Lord said to Moses, "I have heard the grumbling of the people of Israel. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall be filled with bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God. In the evening, quail came up and covered the camp, and in the morning, dew lay around the camp. And when the dew had gone up, there was on the face of the wilderness a fine flake-like thing, fine as frost on the ground. And when the people of Israel saw it, they said to one another, 'What is it?' For they did not know what it was. And Moses said to them, 'It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We sing the gradual in unison from the front of the insert.
Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are His judgments, and how inscrutable His ways. For from Him and through Him and to Him are all things. To Him be glory forever. Amen.
The epistle is from Ephesians chapter 4. I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the one who also ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness in deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the Holy Gospel.
Alleluia.
Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 6th chapter. On the next day, the crowd that remained on the other side of the sea saw that there had been only one boat there, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. Other boats from Tiberias came near the place where they had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when the crowd saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum seeking Jesus. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not labor for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to be doing the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "Then what sign do you do that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform?" Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus then said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They said to him, sir, give us this bread always. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated for the next hymn, number 918.
Land be safe on Canaan's side.
would, take the hymnal and turn to page 324 for a part of the catechism for this week, the fourth petition of the Lord's Prayer, 324. And we're at the bottom left-hand corner of the page, 324. Give us this day our daily bread. What does this mean? God certainly gives daily bread to everyone without our prayers, even to all evil people. But we pray in this petition that God would lead us to realize this and to receive our daily bread with thanksgiving. What is meant by daily bread? Daily bread includes everything that has to do with the support and needs of the body, such as food, drink, clothing, shoes, house, home, land, animals, money, goods, a devout husband or wife, devout children, devout workers, devout and faithful rulers, good government, good weather, peace, health, self-control, good reputation, good friends, faithful neighbors, and the like. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The Old Testament reading today, you got the people of Israel traveling across the wilderness. And what's your impression about how it's going? And they are grumbling. I was talking with Jennifer this morning, and she was pointing out that there is a difference between lamenting, like the Psalms of Lament, and grumbling, right? But you notice here, as you'll see elsewhere in the book of Exodus, who are they grumbling at? Moses and Aaron. And what do they say? Who are we that you should complain about us? Your problem's with God. This was his idea. We're just his instruments carrying it out. Now, I get it, you know. Pastors know, especially, you know, think about this when you're a new pastor in a congregation and we're all getting to know each other, right? Some people are going to like me better than others. I've been through it enough times to know that that's true. And sometimes there are going to be things that happen where people will hear a particular teaching from Scripture, and some people are going to affirm that teaching of Scripture, and some are going to have a problem with it. But sometimes personality stuff and the doctrine stuff get jumbled up in people's minds, or one gets used for this as cover for the other, right? But who am I that you should complain about me? Certainly not perfect, as Moses and Aaron weren't perfect. And how different do you think all 12 of the apostles were from each other? And do you think maybe they had different strengths and weaknesses? And then the Apostle Paul comes around later too, you know? And you know, he often talked about himself the way that Moses would talk about himself, right? You know, remember Moses, who am I that I should go talk to Pharaoh? And, you know, Paul would talk about, I'm not even that good of a speaker. And I've often said, if people who knew me, middle school, high school, wouldn't believe I get up and talk in public every week, and more than that. But God provided for them anyway, didn't he? And we just even said from the catechism, God even gives daily bread to even to evil people. But what does he want? He wants us to receive our daily bread with thanksgiving, no matter what tax bracket you're in. Right? But not everyone who hangs out with Jesus is a believer or a disciple. That doesn't mean Jesus doesn't want them to be. The Scriptures teach God wants all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. But the mission is also repent and believe the gospel. And you can't fake that with God, can you? Because he sees in here. We all just see each other from the outside and we make guesses about motives and all of that and tone of voice. But God sees straight in here. So there's no point of putting on a show for God. But not everyone who talks about Jesus understands what he teaches and who he is and why he came and what he did. And you know that on a basic level, right? Because it's not just Christianity that talks about Jesus. There are other religions that'll call him a prophet, that'll call him a mystical teacher, that will call him a social reformer, all kinds of other things. But of course, we know that's not really grappling with what Jesus did or what he said about himself. And there finally can't be any sitting on the fence about Jesus. You'll either have to think he was a liar or insane or he is who he says he is. There's not really any kind of moderate position about Jesus. But Jesus was now on the other side of the sea and a crowd caught up with him in Capernaum after that feeding of the 5,000 plus. They knew Jesus didn't leave in the boat with the disciples but stayed behind. So they're getting a bit of a headache over it. Nevertheless, here he is in Capernaum with them, and that was curious. How did that happen? So they start out there. Rabbi, when did you come here? And you notice, even after the feeding of the 5,000, you notice how they address him. Not Lord, Rabbi. Slow learners. Right. But they don't set the agenda or the standard for Jesus. He speaks to them, "Most assuredly I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you. Because God the Father has set his seal on him." You notice that? Labor for the stuff that's freely given. What do we worry about? The green stuff. However much that's worth, it'll be worth less tomorrow. Forget about it if you're not making a good interest rate, right? It's going to evaporate probably in a few weeks. Who knows? But I think, do not labor for these things that moth and rust can destroy. But you notice also something important here. Volunteers for Jesus. Ever notice something about volunteers for Jesus in the Gospels? Remember the rich young ruler. "Good teacher, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" And then there's the discussion about the Ten Commandments. "Oh yeah, I've kept that from my youth," right? And it says, "Then Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, 'One thing you lack, go your way, sell whatever you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come take up the cross and follow me.'" And it says, "And he was sad at this word and went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions." So how much did it end up being worth to him? Or remember in Luke 9, "Now as it happened as they journeyed on the road that someone said to him, 'Lord, I will follow you wherever you go.' And Jesus said to him, 'Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head.' Then he said to another, 'Follow me.' But he said, 'Lord, let me first go and bury my father.' Jesus said to him, 'Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and preach the kingdom of God.' And another also said, 'Lord, I will follow you, but let me first go and bid them farewell who are at my house.' But Jesus said to them, 'No one, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God.'" Volunteers for Jesus. How's that for a good evangelism program? How's that for shepherding and church growth? How's that for interpersonal skills and winsomeness? How does that fit with our modern sensibilities? But the Lord does His law and gospel work on you to have you, for Him to have you on His terms, and not for you to have God on your terms. That's how it works. That's discipleship. That's following the Lord. That's repentance. Now, that's a way of looking at the Scriptures where you come to understand you're not interpreting them, but they're interpreting you. He's in the driver's seat. But the Lord does His law and gospel work on you so that you would be clothed with Christ and not with the fig leaf of offering up our hearts and our own righteousness and works as a reason why God would take you in. There is nothing in me that makes me worthy to stand before God. There's nothing in me that makes me worthy to stand right here. We have this ministry by the mercy of God, St. Paul says. But divine mercy without any merit or worthiness in me is different than volunteers for Jesus. He drafts you. Right? It is not by our own reason or strength that we believe in Jesus Christ our Lord or come to Him, but the Holy Ghost has called us by the gospel. We do God no favors and cannot improve upon His ways or be more successful than God, who gives all these things as pure gift. Any appearances to the contrary are only that, appearances. So don't count the beans until the last day. Don't count the church growth until then later. Don't count the church growth until you're standing and see the Lamb upon the throne, the Lamb who was slain and yet lives. Then you'll see how the church has grown out of all the congregations in the world who were faithful to Christ. But a stress-free budget or a personality cult is no way to outgame the law and the gospel having their way with you, no matter how liberal or conservative or stodgy or nice kind of church you have. But Jesus speaks to them, "Most assuredly I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate the loaves and were filled." Very human level, isn't it? But kind of goes along with the church shopping and hopping phenomenon today, and you thought consumer society was a new thing. They had it back then. They felt fed, and they were seeking the bread of life. Or maybe was it just a potluck with Jesus? Were they seeking a clever teacher or wanting the words of eternal life that would give them life out of death and lift them out of the grave on the last day? Were they remembering how short this life is? Were they having the fear of missing out in this life or craving eternal life in the one who is eternal life? Were they seeking a buddy and a problem solver or a Lord and Savior? But Jesus says to them, "Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set His seal on them." But they're getting worked up about the temporary, transitory, perishable things of this dying world in these end times. An itch, a feeling, instant gratification, escape. Maybe turning Jesus into a magical friend. But anything but the food which endures to everlasting life through the one who would be crucified and raised from the dead, Him who was sent from the Father. But how different this way of Jesus is from the advice of the experts and leaders of our day. But how utterly focused Jesus is on the real problem and the real rescue for us out of divine love and compassion for us who sometimes have to be pulled to even think of Him. And He comes not just to rescue us from stress for a moment, but to give us life and peace for eternity. For we know that in him, whatever even isn't healed in this life will be healed in eternity. That's his guarantee. As surely as Christ is raised from the dead, so will you be. For death has no more dominion over him. But every other way we look and seek will come up short under God's word. All the other misguided longings and wants of our desires, diversions, hobbies, money, power, drugs, sex, religious experiences, and even making good things higher than God himself. For we need to remember not to love the created things more than the Creator himself. But all else will fall short of the glory of God, because nothing can be greater than God who comes to us. And we should know that when we are tempted and caught off guard by these things, Satan certainly knows how to manipulate your inner psychology and your feelings and your insecurities of worry and coveting and being in control. And he's very good at it. And some of us find that out the hard way sometimes, don't we? You've got the scars to prove it. But then they said to him, "What shall we do that we may work the works of God?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent." The work of God is not a how-to for you. It's the fact that you believe is his work in you. This is the if-then statement of the human heart of legalisms, the opinion of the lawgiver. You do this, God will do that, as if God is a great vending machine in the sky. That is not love. What should I do to get on good terms with God? Hoops to jump through, works to do, donations, pilgrimages, church work, meetings to attend. What is the method or rule? What's the technique? What is the spiritual progress I have to make happen? This is the work of God, that you believe in him who forgives all your sins and forgives the sins of the whole world, because he paid for them on the cross. But why do we think this legalistic way? What, will God be cajoled? Will God be impressed or bought off or bribed or intimidated or embarrassed or coerced to do something for us? No, that's paganism. That's not the God of the Bible. But why do we do this? Do we think this is a way of maintaining control or avoiding the feeling of floating in midair in our life or avoiding the fear of not getting the result we hoped for or the way we hoped our life would go? And we don't realize that in Christ we have been brought out of death to life. You don't see it yet, but you are already living in eternity as you dwell in Christ. But the natural man does not understand the things of the Spirit of God. His vision is clouded. None are righteous, no, not one. We are brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did our mother conceive us. From our tiniest moment, we inherit this disease. So wretched man that I am, that we all are. Lost, of unclean lips, defiled, rebellious, hateful toward God and his word, hateful towards others, spiritually dead, paralyzed, separated, without fellowship. That's the natural state of man without Christ since the fall of Adam and Eve. That's the target of missionary preaching, of evangelistic outreach. And that's where we would be without him. And that's why we are here, because that's not the case for us, and we want to remain steadfast in him and urge one another likewise in love for one another. But it isn't getting volunteers for an organization or affiliating with a religious group merely for ideas that you have in common, or even because we want to say we're nicer than everybody else, all the other groups out there. But faith comes through this word that we gather around, and the good shepherd Jesus gathers his sheep by his word. And through the washing of water with the word, new disciples are made. And in being taught the Word, we come to learn that faith more clearly, day by day, year after year. And while we cannot, by our own reason or strength, believe in Christ, He has become our Good Samaritan, we who are left for dead along the side of the road by everyone else. The Word who became flesh and made His dwelling among us brings us life and forgiveness and rescue while we were yet sinners and enemies of God, while we were quite tangled up in the mess of our own lives and our own confused thinking. But Jesus is the bread of life. He says to you, I am the bread of life. He is the divine one who came down and offers us nourishment unto eternal life. And the Father sent the eternal Son to graciously be our substitute so that we would not receive the punishment we all have deserved. Willingly, Jesus did this in obedience to His Father. But the bread of God is Jesus, who continues to come down from heaven for you right here, week after week, to feed you with His body and blood at the altar, to nourish you with His Word put into your ears. Graciously, this gift is offered to you so that you can hear that truth and echo it out to others. But that is His promise, backed up by His own bodily resurrection from the dead. This life is not all there is. So there is no fear of missing out if you live in eternity. Jesus miraculously continues to feed us that we know who He is and what He has done for us. There is nothing to do then than to be at the receiving end of those gifts with a hearty amen and trust in the Lord's promise. That is the work of God, that you believe in Him who is the bread of life. Amen. And now the peace of God, which surpasses all our understanding, keep your hearts and minds in true faith in Christ to life everlasting. Amen. We stand and sing, Create in Me. Let us pray. O Lord, our God, we acknowledge Your great goodness toward us and praise You for the mercy and grace that our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, and our hearts have known. We sincerely repent of the sins of this day and those in the past. Pardon our offenses, correct and reform what is lacking in us by Your word, and help us to grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as we receive the forgiveness of sins. Inscribe Your law upon our hearts and equip us to serve You with holy and blameless lives, with virtue and wisdom. And may each day remind us of the coming of the night when no one can work and our Lord appears again in power and glory. In the emptiness of this present age, keep us united by a living faith through the power of Your Holy Spirit with Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, that we may escape the eternal bitter pains of condemnation through the redemption that we have in Jesus. Lord, in Your mercy, by Your Holy Spirit, bless the preaching of Your word and the administration of Your sacraments here in this place. Preserve these gifts to us and to all Christians throughout the world. Guard and protect us from all dangers to body and soul, and grant that we may with faithful perseverance receive from You our sorrows as well as our joys, knowing that health and sickness, riches and poverty, and all things come by permission of your fatherly hand. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we also pray for all those dealing with ongoing health challenges, recovering from surgery, or other chronic issues. Especially we pray for Judy as she recovers from surgery, for Suzanne, for Marilyn, for Dennis Johnson, and for any others amongst our family and friends. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, we also pray for your comfort upon the peace, your comfort and peace upon the family of Carol Meyer as they grieve her departure from this life. And we pray that they would keep their eyes fixed upon Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Lord, in your mercy. Deliver us from sin and error, from the frailties of the flesh, the allurements of this present age, and the temptations of the devil. Give us faith that works in love, hope that never disappoints, patience that does not fail, confidence in you that never wavers, and courage always ready to confess Christ, that we may live in your mercy and die in your peace. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We continue on 194.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord God of Sabaoth. Heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna.
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, On the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. O Christ, thou Lamb of God,
thank you.
we stand and sing the Nunc Dimittis.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good.
We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. The Lord be with you. Bless we the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Amen. Please be seated. The last hymn is 516.
And all her heart with Shining forth.